This is the home of Carl Gustav Jung on the Lake of Zurich. In the summer of 1957, two professors from the University of Houston, one a film producer and the other a psychologist, came to Zurich to film a series of interviews with Dr. Jung. What follows is a part of these interviews in which Jung speaks of Freud.
Now, Dr. Jung, many of us who have read a great deal of your work, of course, are aware of the fact that in your early work, you were, to some degree, at least in association with Dr. Sigmund Freud. And I know it would be of great interest to many of us to hear a little bit about how you happened to hear of Dr. Freud and how you happened to become involved with some of his work and ideas.
Well, as a matter of fact, it was in the year 1900, in December, soon after Freud's book about dream interpretation had come out, that I was asked by my chief, Professor Pleuler, to give a review of the book. I studied the book very attentively, and I didn't understand many things in it, which weren't clear at all to me. But from others, parts, I got the impression that this man really knew what he was talking about. And I thought that this is certainly a masterpiece, full of future.
Yes.
I had no idea then of ideas of my own. I was just it was just when I began to my career as an assistant,
yeah,
in the psychiatric clinic. And then I began with experimental psychology or psychopathology. I applied the experimental association method by Wundt, and the same that has been applied in the Grappelin's psychiatric clinic in Munich. I had studied the results, and I had the idea one should go once more over it. So I made these association tests, and I found out that the important thing in them has been missed, because it is not interesting to see that there is a reaction, a certain reaction to a stimulus world. That is more or less uninteresting. But the interesting thing is why people could not react to certain stimulus words, or in an entirely inadequate way. And then I began to study these places in the experiment where the attention or the capability, apparently, of the test person began to waver or to disappear. And I found soon out that it is a matter of intimate personal affairs people were thinking of, or which were in them, even if they momentarily did not think of them, when they were unconscious, with other words, that nevertheless an inhibition came from the unconscious and hindered the expression in speech.
Yes.
And then I, in examining all these cases as carefully as possible, I saw that it was matter of what Freud called repressions.
Yes.
I also saw what he meant by symbolization.
In other words, from your word association studies, some of the things in the interpretation of dreams began to fall into place.
Quite
your own thinking.
Right. And then I wrote a book about the psychology of dementia praecox, it was called, now schizophrenia.
Yes.
And I sent the book to Freud and wrote to him about my association experiments and how they confirmed his theory thus far.
Yes.
And that is how it began, my friendship with Freud began.
Now, one of the, of course, very fundamental ideas in the original psychoanalytic theory was Freud's conception of the libido as sort of a broad psychic sexual energy. And When did you, of course, we all know that you began to feel that, that Dr. Freud might have had perhaps a little bit too much stress on sexuality in his theory. Now, when did you begin first feeling this? In other words, was this a sort of a feeling that you had almost from the beginning? Or as time went by, did you begin to feel this way?
Well, you see, in the beginning, I had naturally certain prejudices against his conceptions. And after a while, I overcame them. I could do that from owing to my biological training.
Yes.
And I could not deny the importance of the sexual instinct, you know.
Yes.
But later on, I saw that it was very one-sided. Because, you see, man is not only governed by the sex instinct, there are other instincts as well. For instance, in biology, you see, the nutritional instinct is just as important as the sex instinct. Also, in primitive societies, sexuality plays a role much smaller than food. Food is the all-important interest and desire.
Yes.
Sex, that is something I can have everywhere. They are not shy. But the food is difficult to obtain, you see?
Yes, yes.
And so it is the main interest.
Yes.
And then in other societies, for instance, in civilized societies, the power drive plays a much greater role than sex.
Yes.
For instance, there are many big businessmen who are impotent, even.
Yes.
Because their whole energy is going into money-making.
Yes.
Or dictating the laws to everybody
yes.
else.
Yes.
That's yes. much more interesting than affairs with women.
So, in a sense, as you began to look over Dr. Freud's emphasis on the sexual drive, you began to think in terms of other cultures and the broader ideas, and it began to seem to you that this wasn't really an emphasis that was universal or sufficiently universal to be important. Is this the sort of thing?
Well, you know, I couldn't help seeing it because I had studied Nietzsche. I knew the works of Nietzsche very well. He was had been a professor at Bali University,
yes,
you know,
yes.
and the air was full of talk about Nietzsche.
Yes.
And so naturally I had studied his works here, and there I saw an entirely different psychology.
Yes.
Which was also psychology, perfectly competent psychology,
yes.
but all built upon the power drive.
Yes. Do you think it's possible that Dr. Freud was either ignoring Nietzsche or had perhaps not wanted to be influenced by Nietzsche?
His personal
yes.
motivation?
Yes.
Well, of course, it was a personal prejudice. You see, it happened to be his main point, you know. Certain people are chiefly looking for this side and other people to another side.
Yes.
So, you see, the inferior Dr. Adler, the younger, the weaker, naturally had a power complex.
Yes.
He wanted to be the successful man. Freud was a successful man. He was on top. And so he was interested only in pleasure,
yes.
in the pleasure principle,
yes.
and while Adler was interested in the power drive.
Yes.
Sure enough.
I see. In other words, you feel that it's sort of a function of his own personality to some degree.
Yeah, it is quite natural. You
yes.
see, it is one of the two ways how to deal with reality.
Yes.
Either you make reality an object of your pleasure, if you are powerful enough already,
yes.
or you make it an object of your desire to grab it.
Yes, yes.
Or now, to possess it.
Yes. Now, of course, some observers have thought that perhaps the patients that Dr. Freud saw in Vienna of this period were often individuals who were repressed sexually.
Oh, yes.
And that perhaps that so many of the patients having been of this type,
yes.
That this may have been one thing that sort of reinforced Dr.
Yeah.
Freud's ideas. In other words, in a sense that the Viennese society was a rather, quote, repressed society. Now, would you think that this might have been a factor?
Well, that this is certainly so, that in the end of the Victorian age, there was a reaction going over the whole world against the taboos, the sex taboos,
yes,
I don't call,
yes,
call
yes.
them. One didn't understand anymore properly why or why not.
Yes.
And Freud belongs into that time, a sort of liberation of the mind of such taboos.
Yes. So it's a reaction then against the the sort of tight, inhibited
yes.
culture he was living
oh,
in.
Oh, yes. And you see, Freud in that way, on that side, really belonged to the category of a Nietzschean mind.
Yes.
Nietzsche had liberated Europe from a great deal of such prejudices, but on concerning the power drive.
Yes.
And
yes.
our illusions as to the motivations of our morality.
Yes.
It was a time critical of morality.
Yes. And so then, in a sense, Dr. Freud was taking it in another direction
and
with equal amount of force.
And then, moreover, you know, it is sex being the main instinct, the predominating instinct in a more or less safe society.
Yes.
Where the social conditions are more or less safe, there sexuality is apt to predominate.
Yes.
Because people are taken care of, they have their positions, they have enough food, no
yes.
question of hunting and seeking food or something like that. Then it is quite probable that the patients you meet have more or less all a certain sexual complex.
So this is, in a sense, then the drive in that particular society most likely to be inhibited.
It is a sort of finesse, almost, when you find out that somebody has a power drive, you know?
Yes.
And where sex only serves the purpose of power, for instance, a charming man, you know, all women think he is the real hero of all hearts.
Yes.
He is a power devil.
Yes, yes.
Like a Don Juan, you know, the woman is not his problem. His problem is how to dominate.
Yes, this is indeed very interesting.
You see? And so you see, in the second place, after sex, comes the power drive. And even that is not the end.
Yes. Now, in the going sort of fundamentally through the development of Dr. Freud's theory, which of course was a sort of a significant factor in, as you say, in the development of many of your own early ideas, Dr. Freud, of course, talked a great deal about the unconscious.
The unconscious is something which is really unconscious.
Yeah.
And so you have no object. You
yeah,
see nothing.
Yeah. No.
You only can make inferences, you know.
Yeah.
And so we have to create a model
yeah.
of this possible structure of yeah. the unconscious because we can't see it.
Yeah.
Now, you see, he came to the concept of the unconscious chiefly on the basis of the same experience I had made in the association experiment, namely that people reacted, they said things, they did things without knowing that they did it or said it.
Yes.
And this is something you can observe experimentally in the association experiment, where people cannot remember afterwards what they did or what they said in the moment where a stimulus word hits the complex.
Yes.
With the reproduction, in the so-called reproduction experiment, you go through the whole list and you will see that the memory fails where there was a complex reaction.
Yes.
And that is the simple fact
yes.
Freud has based his idea of the unconscious on, because that is kind of what you can see
yes.
time and again, that people, for instance, make a mistake in speech.
Yes.
Or that they say something which they didn't mean to say.
Yes.
Make ridiculous mistakes,
yes,
you know.
Yes.
There are no end of stories, you know,
yes.
you know about how people can betray themselves by saying something they didn't mean to say
yes.
at all, yet in the unconscious meant him to say that thing, just that thing.
Yeah. Yes.
For instance, when you want to express your sympathy at a funeral, you know, to somebody, you say, I congratulate you, you say, that's pretty painful, you know, but that happens, and,
yeah.
and it is true.
Yeah.
Now, this is something that goes parallel now with the whole school of the Salpêtrière in Paris. There was Pierre Janet, who has worked out that side, of the unconscious reactions, quite particularly.
Yes.
Now Freud refers very little to Pierre Janet.
Well,
I have studied with Pierre Janet in Paris.
Yes.
And he has formed my ideas very much. He was a first-class observer, though he had no dynamic theory about, no psychological theory.
Yes.
It was a sort of physiological theory.
Yes.
Of the unconscious phenomena as a so-called abaissement du niveau mental.
Yes.
That means a certain depotentiation of the tension of consciousness.
Yes.
It sinks below the level of consciousness and thus becomes unconscious.
Yes.
Now, that is Freud's view too.
Yes.
Only he says it sinks down because it is helped, it is repressed.
Yes.
From above.
Yes. Yes.
Then that was my first point of difference with Freud.
Yes.
I say there are cases in my observation where there was no repression from above, but the thing itself withdrew.
Yes.
Those contents that became unconscious had withdrawn all by themselves.
Yes.
They were not repressed.
Yes.
On the contrary.
Yes. Yes.
They have a certain autonomy. There I discovered the concept of autonomy.
Yes.
And that these contents that disappear have the power to move independently from my will. Either they appear when I want to say something definite, they interfere and say and speak themselves instead of what I wanted to say.
Yes.
Or they make me do something which I didn't want to do at all. Or they withdraw in the moment where I want to use them.
Yes.
They certainly disappear.
And this is independent of any of the, you might say in a sense, of the pressures on the conscious as Freud would have
interpreted. Yeah, there can be such cases, sure.
Yes.
Enough.
Yes.
But beside them, there are also the cases that show that the unconscious contents acquire a certain independence. And all mental contents that have a certain feeling tone that is emotional, has the value of an emotion, of an affect,
yes,
have the tendency to become autonomous.
Yes.
So you see, anybody in an emotion will say and do things which he cannot vouch for.
Yes.
He must excuse himself after that. I was in a state, you know.
Yes.
He was not corpus mentis.
Yes. Now, in addition to, of course, the repression, or the fact that repressed material is present in the unconscious, of course, as I pointed out before, and as you mentioned briefly, Dr. Freud recognized that, in a sense, the individual was born sort of, entirely sort of a victim of what he later called an id, or a total sort of unconscious, undeveloped, sort of a total animal organism. And he, I think it is not very easily seen where all these drives, all these instincts came from, as if there's some allusion to the fact that they are the result of phylogenetic inheritance, that they are carried over from previous developments.
You see, nobody knows where instincts come from.
Yes.
They are there, you find them. That is a story that has been played millions of years ago.
Yes.
You know,
their yes.
sexuality has been invented, and I wasn't there, so I don't know how it has happened.
Yes.
Feeding has been invented very much longer than
yes.
even sex, and why and how it has been invented, I don't know. I haven't been there. So we don't know where that thing comes from.
Yes.
And it's quite ridiculous, you know, to speculate about such an impossibility.
Yes.
So the question is only, where do those cases come from where instinct does not function?
Yes.
That is something within our reach.
Yes.
Because
yes.
we can study the cases where instinct does not function.
Yes. Now, could you give us some rather specific examples of what you mean of cases where the instinct does not function?
Oh, well, you see, you instead of instinct, which is a habitual form of activity, you know,
yes.
take any other form of habitual activity. And once, suddenly, that thing doesn't function. But take a singer.
Yes.
Who is absolutely controlling his voice.
Yes.
Suddenly he can't sing.
Yes.
Yeah. Or any other, for take a man who writes fluently, suddenly he makes a ridiculous mistake. And there his habit doesn't function.
Yes.
Or, you see, when you ask me something, I'm supposed to be able to react to you. Certainly I'm bouche béante. For instance, if you succeed to touch one of my complexes, you can see me that I'm absolutely perplex. I'm dépossédé.
Yeah.
Well, and words fail me.
Yeah. Well, we haven't seen you very perplexed yet, actually.
look, for instance, at exam psychology, you know, a fellow who knows stuff quite well. The professor asked him, he cannot say a word.
Yes, a block.
Yeah,
a block. Now, going a little further, another part of Dr. Freud's theory, of course, which became very important, as we've already alluded to, was the idea of the conscious, that out of this sort of an unconscious, instinctual structure that the individual has, that out of this emerges as a result of this structure's. Of course, the word structure has to be put in quotation marks, as you point out, this is only a model. But as this structure comes in contact with reality of the world, out of it begins to emerge as a consciousness, man's conception almost of himself. Now, Freud then, of course, called this structure the ego.
Yes.
Now, his ego then was really the product of reality, in a sense also perhaps the product of frustration as the individual developed. Now,
you speak of the general psychological conception of the ego.
Yes, uh-huh. Yes. Now, in your work, of course, you also are interested in this conscious totality, in the total organism. Now, is your what about your conception of this conscious totality? Would you agree, for example, with the statement that this is something that emerges out of man's contact with reality?
But that he has an ego at all? That is your question?
Yes.
Oh. Well, you see, that's again such a case. I hadn't been there when it was invented. Although, you see, you can observe it to a certain extent with a child.
Yeah.
Because a child definitely begins in a state where there is no ego.
Yes.
And then about the fourth year or before, you know, but about that time, the child develops a sense of ego, I myself.
Yes.
And that is, in the first place, a certain identity with the body.
Yes.
For instance, when you ask primitives, then they emphasize always the body.
Yes.
When, for instance, you ask now, who has brought this thing here? The Negro will say, I have brought it.
Yes.
No accent on the I.
Yes.
Simply brought it.
Yes.
And they say, but have you brought it? And he says, indio, mimi.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
yes, I myself, this
here, an object.
this thing here.
Yes.
So the identity, you know, with the body is one of the first things which make an ego. It is the spatial separateness that induces apparently the concept of an ego, and then of course a lot of other things later on. It is mental differences, personal differences of all sorts, etc. You see the ego is continuously building up. It is not a finished product, never.
Yes.
Builds up. You see, no year passes where you do not discover a new little aspect in which you are more ego than you thought.
Yes. Of course, one of the central parts of the so-called psychosexual development in the more or less orthodox psychoanalytic theory is the so-called Oedipus complex.
Yes,
I believe the term complex was yours originally.
Well, that is just what I call an archetype. That
yes.
is the first archetype Freud has discovered. The first and the only one. He thinks that this is the archetype. Of course, there are many such archetypes. You look at Greek mythology and you find Any amount of them. Or look at dreams and you'll find any amount of them. But incest is impressive to him that he even has chosen the term Oedipus complex, because yes, that was one of the outstanding examples of an incest complex.
Yes.
And it is only the masculine form, mind you, yes, because women have an incest complex too, but there it is not an Oedipus.
Yes.
It is something else.
Yes, yes.
And so it is only the term for an archetypal way of behavior in case of a man, a man's relation, say, to his mother. It also means to the daughter, because whatever he was to the mother, he will be it to the daughter too.
Yes.
It
yes
can be this way or that way.
Yes.
It depends.
So you look at, then you will accept, in other words, the Oedipus complex, but not in as being the only important such influence. You will see this is just one of many
many ways of behavior. Now you see, the Oedipus gives you an excellent example of the behavior of an archetype. Now see, the archetype is a force, has an autonomy. It can suddenly seize you. It is like a seizure.
Yes.
So for instance, falling in love at first sight, that is such a case. You see, you have a certain image in yourself, without knowing it, of the woman, of the woman.
Yes.
Now you see that girl, or at least a good imitation of your type. Yes. And instantly you get a seizure, and you're gone.
Yes.
And afterwards you may discover that it was a hell of a mistake. Or you see, a man is quite capable, he's intelligent enough to see that that woman of his choice, as one says, not no choice, he has been captured.
Yeah.
You know, he sees that she's no good at all,
yeah,
that she's a hell of a business. And he tells me so, and he said, for God's sake, doctor, help me to get rid of that woman. He can't. He's like clay in her fingers. And that is the archetype.